if we don't keep emphasizing truth, then the consensus of following the marching orders of time will certainly sweep us along, as the current is so strong. So on the surface, we pretend loyalty to time in our functioning, everyday functioning. Underneath, we say, "Nah, I don't like time. I don't like this." So we have to keep bringing to the surface this part of us that says, "No, I don't like time. I don't want to keep obeying time. Time is crazy. Time doesn't see my options for me. Does not report the truth to me about what my options are." So this world, we have to keep reminding ourselves, it's completely impermanent. It's actually, what it really is gradual loss. And this gradual loss is really a defense against mental chaos. And mental chaos is really a way that, the way that mind symbolizes the idea of annihilation. And the idea of annihilation comes from spirit wanting to be prime greater, which was all one seamless whole. It's impossible to change any part of it. Any desire to change a part of it is a desire for all of it to be completely gone. And had this idea of prime creator spirit, which is what we really are. We're believing that we're bodies in a time, in this gradual loss that we call time. And we're trying to limit loss. We're trying to limit total chaos by having gradual death, gradual chaos, gradual disintegration. And so time tells us that that's all there is. This is all there is. And we pretend to agree to that. We pretend to agree on the surface. But we don't really agree with it. We say, no, I believe there's a way to escape from all this. And there is. There is. Just choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. Idea of not wanting to change reality, or the idea of accepting reality as it is. Or what if reality can't be changed? Just that idea. What if reality can't be changed? And that then doesn't give rise to any annihilation, which is symbolized by the mind. It gives rise to non-judgment, accepting everything as it is, exactly as it is, which in this hypothetical dream of time would mean just an overlay of everything. This feeling that everything is complete. There's a feeling of completeness and stability and peace and stillness. No gradualness, no incompletion, no impermanence, no disintegration. And so we experience that feeling overlaying all of existence, all this impermanence. So we have to keep reminding ourselves back and forth how simple it really is, how easy it really is. And the fact that on the surface, we're just ignoring all this and pretending that none of this exists at all. Really, I just went out today and moving around grocery stores. I went to various places. And you come away just with a complete feeling of obliviousness to what we've been talking about. Utter obliviousness. Wherever you go, there's a sense of obliviousness to it. So everybody is simply obeying the marching orders of time, believing that that's in their best interests, and that's the best that they can do. Now, but beneath the surface, nobody likes it. But when one tries to bring it to the surface, it's difficult. There's resistance. You might feel fatigue, exhaustion. That comes from a deep resistance, a deep fear. And so, even though on paper it's simple, the game is not played on paper. And it is very, very difficult to continuously to bring it up to the surface. It's like trying to land a whale, you know, or some leviathan. You're trying to reel it in, and it's just, oh my gosh, it takes all the energy out of you. That is what we have to do, and hopefully at some point the affirmations will kick in, and the experience that we've invited for will arrive, and at that point no more of this severe fatigue will have ended the strain. the form of gradualness we call gradual loss, you could say the form of gradual loss that we call this hedge is not causing me the slightest bit of, it's not causing me to feel the slightest bit of gradualness right now. So the form of gradual loss that we call ... is not causing me the slightest, not causing me to feel the slightest bit of gradualness right now. It's the basic form, format. You can use slight little variations. The heat wave is over here. The great air conditioner in the sky has been turned on, and it's been, the winds have been absolutely surging, cold winds. The temperature dropped 20 degrees in a short period of time, from 90 to 70. So the form of gradual loss we call temperature drop, temperature variation, is not causing me to feel the slightest bit of gradualness right now. It's not causing me to feel the slightest bit of incompleteness right now. So this form of gradual loss we call temperature variation is not causing me to feel the slightest bit of gradualness right now. And that form can be practiced and practiced, but when you practice, you might feel fatigue. You might feel fatigue. In fact, you probably will. You wonder why I feel so tired. Because you're really going against the taboos of time. Time has all these taboos, and time will never suggest this type of affirmation to you. It's taboo to time. So when breaking a taboo, it's always makes you feel tired. Like if you're told when you're young, you're told all these spooky stories. If you do this, it's very dangerous and frightening, and it's all made up. And then someday you go past this place that you've told it's really dangerous and frightening, and realize it's nothing there. And then you go, oh, that's relief. And afterwards you'll feel very tired. You say, why do I feel so tired? Because subconsciously you had a lot of fear about it, about what's going to happen. Maybe there's something behind all this, these ghost stories. So working on these, this requires effort. It will be fatiguing. You can do it, a burst of it, as it were, and then rest, and then another burst, and then rest. It is tough to continuously do it. I don't continuously do it. I don't know. It's very difficult. But usually it is. You go through a concentrated effort, and then you need to take a breather. You feel like you've been boxing with someone that you're exhausted. Because you've been really pushing past the barriers that you have set, and that have been, everyone else agrees with. Getting past this barrier is going into the edge of the world. Like in the Middle Ages, they thought the ocean, there was a point when the ocean just dropped off into an abyss, thinking the world was flat. At least some popular mythology had it was flat. So it's like you're sailing along, and you think, I'm getting into the area I've never gotten into. Maybe I'll just drop off into an abyss. And so there's this concern, and that brings up a lot of exhaustion. So don't think that anyone has to be a superstar, just continuously do it like, oh, there's no reaction. Oh, there's a backlash. Most definitely, every video, sooner or later, I'm going to feel some exhaustion. In fact, all of this is causing severe exhaustion. Everything I've done in life has caused severe exhaustion because pushing through these barriers, continuously pushing through the barriers. So existence has not been fun at all. Because I'm always continuously exhausted. It's the price you pay. You're going to climb Mount Everest, you're going to feel tired. There's just no way around it. And you just put up with the suffering because you know that when you get to the top, the reward is going to be worth it. So So obviously, we cannot have a society that is based on peak effort, peak functionality as far as productivity, etc., and still have a viable spiritual culture at all. It's impossible. You have to have a culture that does not value peak performance. Rather, it values spending time pushing past the barriers of time, all the taboos of time, which of course is going to make you less than effective as far as peak performance goes, most definitely. If you're really giving everything you got, you're probably going to be feel tired all the time. And when you feel tired all the time, you need to rest. You actually need to rest quite a bit. It's kind of like if you're pregnant, you cannot be expected to be giving in peak performance because you're giving a lot of energy to the pregnancy, and you want to do that the best that's best possible. So you cannot should not be expected to be giving in your peak performance during that time. Well, the spiritual path is the same like that. It is you are giving birth to a decision and an acceptance. And this causes enormous, you're struggling against enormous restrictions and repressions and fears and taboos and challenging them, which is quite exhausting. And constant changes of perspective. And there's no way you are going to be a peak performer. No way. So if a society values peak performance and everybody's educated and the whole economic system is based on peak performance, you have a non-spiritual culture. You have a culture that is actually marching into the jaws of time and becoming bound to time, as it were, becoming addicted to time, becoming subservient and enslaved to the marching orders of time, which is an extraordinarily unwelcome development. Whereas if you have a society that doesn't care about peak performance, not even an issue. The issue is to help as many as possible, as fast as possible, do the necessary considerations to exchange time for timelessness. You're going to have a society. Obviously, it's not going to be sending people to the moon. All right? But why we don't need to send people to the moon? It's not going to be modifying the climate. We don't need to modify the climate. It's not going to be tearing all the minerals out of the earth and polluting all the fresh water on the planet. We don't need that. We don't need all these things. We can just build things out of renewable resources, as a matter of fact. Use rattan, bamboo, and just use easily renewable resources. We don't need all the gouging out and chopping of everything in the world at which peak performance has led to. You can have a simple society, simple culture that allows people to have some time to be tired. It's okay to be tired and fatigued from the struggle. Now, we don't want a too primitive a society because that actually entails a lot of work too. So there is a balance that can be struck, actually. There is a balance. Certainly some invention, some innovation is helpful. But that cannot become an ideal, an end in itself. In other words, it should not be, the ideal should not be peak performance. If the world could turn in that direction, then the world could really make something of itself as far as graduating from time, getting free of time, getting enlightened, getting deliverance from time and impermanence. That could happen. But problem is that we have this culture that worships peak performance in every possible way. And that does preclude an effective spiritual path. It precludes it. See, my performance in life is sort of bottom rung type of thing, barely able to get by. no peak performance at all, just scuffling along, stumbling along, really. But when it comes to spiritual clarity, it's the opposite. I'm getting peak performance there, and great results there. So what's of more value? And we can't do it both. We can't have it both ways. Cannot have it both ways, because the effort and energy and nerve that go into the spiritual path are so enormous, there is no way you can have it both ways. Totally impossible. Because whatever energy you're pouring into a peak performance, that's being taken away from the spiritual path, which requires enormous perseverance and patience and ability to withstand tiredness and fatigue, just like climbing like a Mount Everest. You're gonna, each step, you feel so tired after each step once you get up a high elevation. And you just have to wait, be patient, and gather your strength, and then take another step, gather your strength, take another step. It's like that. You're not going to be running up the mountain. So culture says, well, if you can't run up a mountain, lickety-split, and run down and feel no fatigue, then you shouldn't even climb the mountain at all and spend time doing something else. That precludes the spiritual path. Absolutely does. People are going to have all sorts of struggles and difficulties freeing themselves from these taboos. These difficulties can manifest in endless different ways. Go through all sorts of phases, all sorts of different steps, and each one has its own struggle and difficulty to it. So it's really a vocation. It's really a career. And we shouldn't have piled on our shoulders on top of that the notion that we should do everything else in a peak way. You know, have the ultimate material luxuries and beauty and sophistication, ultimate in recreation, the ultimate in relationships, the ultimate in food, the ultimate in every possible spectrum of our career, everything. In other words, ultimate in financial success and health and all that kind of stuff. There's no way. Spiritual path does take a toll on your life all around. It takes a toll on it. So, this present culture is, again, inimical to the spiritual path. The world culture that's coming into place, clicking into place, is entirely inimical to the spiritual path. It does not allow for it. And therefore, what it will do is simply define whatever it does allow for, like maybe a weekend yoga retreat of stretching and deep breathing or something. It'll call that, and say, that's the spiritual path. That's where it's all at. It will just define that within the parameters of its demands for peak performance from everyone. Then whatever little crumbs are left over, it'll define that as that's as much as you get. So let's just call that the spiritual path and call it good. They'll say, well, let's call it good. Well, it doesn't work that way. You cannot just call it good and have it good. The feeling of incompleteness of time is still present. Time to switch on the lights because the sun has set. One moment, please. All right, let me adjust the lighting here now that the full blast is there. Okay, so what do we do when we have this culture like this? Well, it's tough, very tough. I'm finding it to be extremely difficult, actually. Uh, how can you put in this, how can you keep up appearances in a peak effort culture? How do we manage to do that? It's very difficult. We have no choice. We have to do the best we can with the situation we're in. You know, we've got no excuses, and making excuses isn't going to help us at all. But I definitely try to do it all, but cannot. And so some things lag, and I try to push myself almost to death to try and deal with everything, but it's just too doggone difficult. And now looking ahead, looking at the future, I say, huh? All right, so I'm getting interrupted with frequency these days. That's not a good thing. Probably by design. But there's another thing that happens in this peak performance culture. We do not respect at all those who are engaged in the spiritual path. We feel that it's detracting from peak performance, and we see no utility or importance to it whatsoever. So you're likely to have much support for this. All right, people think, oh, you're just a bum. You're just taking it easy. You know, in other words, you're not engaging in peak performance. Well, it's not true. You're engaging in peak performance on the spiritual path, which is immeasurably more important. So we have our values upside down and backwards on this planet, and the future is immeasurably worse, as far as I can tell. The trending is so severe now, from age now, they're being indoctrinated with the most severe kind of pressures to worship peak performance, and their whole life is just geared to that. It's like they're junkies from the get-go. It's like parents feeding their children heroin from day one. It's really like that, and the child has not the slightest notion that something else is possible. Now, of course, there could be a backlash from that, and people could just drop out, but that's an uneven thing. You know, rebellion is not the answer. You're looking for a sane, smooth society, not just simple rebellion and dropping out and all that kind of stuff like the 60s. You know, the 60s were rebellion against the 40s and the 50s of peak performance, of corporate peak performance culture, and people just said, hey, we don't want too much. So they kind of dropped out, but it was a very ragged, uneven kind of thing. And ultimately, the backlash came back, and peak performance came back stronger than ever. Only now, it's enculturated in every level of society. Both genders now are hold that up to as ultimate ideal. It used to be that the feminine gender did not worship a peak performance as much because they're more into raising kids and letting the kids be kids, all right, and understanding that you shouldn't demand peak performance of children too soon. It's not good for them. But that's all changed now, where now you have the helicopter moms and dads that it's all about peak performance. They don't let kids just be kids. It's they're pushing earlier and earlier and earlier and earlier. So the feminine component of the planet has taken up this idea of peak performance now like a religion, ferociously so, and looks down on any male that is not into peak performance. And so that you have a whole world culture at this point where it didn't used to be this bad, actually. They didn't have to be thinking, what are we doing every minute? They didn't have to be having us, you know, try and get us to be peak performers every second of the day, watching us, monitoring us, testing us, bringing us into the doctor and getting shots and straightening our teeth and getting us the right clothes and all this kind of stuff. I said, no, just let the intuitive wisdom of the children, let that come to the front. If they have something, it will come to the front. Let's not, you know, micromanage their lives and try to force them into a cookie cutter mold. All that's, you know, gone with the wind now. Gone with the wind. And so, children, again, I told you, I've told in other places, the doctors will tell you now that, like, my gosh, their patients are younger and younger and younger now with stress diseases of older people who have, like, gone through a lifetime of forcing peak performance, come down with certain stress illnesses. And he says, now young people are coming in with the illness they shouldn't be getting until they're old. He said, it's just this drastic change has come about. These are doctors talking. The stresses of the planet are enormous. Just look at the honeybees and their disappearance. People say, well, what's causing it? What's causing it is stress. The whole planet's under stress. We tend to think in terms of stress as only a human thing, but no, it's not true. Look at all the species of plants and animals, flora and fauna, that are going extinct constantly on this planet. It's just overwhelming. I don't even want to think about it because it's too tragic to even contemplate. It's madness. All coming from this ideal of peak performance, of time wanting to control everything, everything under control. Avoiding a spiritual path at all costs brings ruination. If we had still simple agrarian societies with some innovation, the world would not be under stress like it is now. First of all, the population would probably be around 2 billion instead of 7. The smog, the pollution of our fresh water, the ocean, all this stuff would not be there at all. Just wouldn't be there. That's not to say the life would be fine. It wouldn't. It'd still be miserable. But we would not be, the planet would not be under so much stress. And we wouldn't be facing the prospect of losing, you know, our honeybees and the pollinators, some of our main pollinators of our food. And now we're headed for some drastic times in the future. Stress, just like stress breaks a body down, stress breaks a planet down. And this planet is under impossible stress from time, the mentality of time, which is to use every effort to be a peak performer. Don't give any energy to spiritual consideration at all. Stay completely geeked up on this idea of trying to control everything monitored and controlled as a way to defend against mental chaos. So time, uninformed, the mentality of time, if we remain uninformed about our true option, which is to exchange a new hypothetical, exchange hypotheticals, we then get into this peak performance mania, which stresses our environment and the entire planet, as well as the surrounding cosmos, actually, which has severe consequences for us. And the honeybee thing is obviously a big alarm. It's like a 5-alarm fire. It's a combination of factors, but it's, of course, they list all the factors. They leave out electromagnetic radiation, microwave radiation. They leave that out, which affects the bees' geomagnetic navigating systems. So the bees and lots of animals, same thing with birds, all those who, you know, use navigation heavily, they found out now that there's magnetic geosensors in animals that enable them to actually navigate extraordinarily well. And that radiation, like from cell phone towers and satellites, just basic, all this radiation we have now, artificial changing. So much has changed. The magnetic resonance of the earth is changing. All of this affects animals' ability to navigate, and a lot of migratory birds are becoming extinct. They can't migrate anymore. So we're missing obstacles from this ideal of peak performance. Drastic troubles. However, remember that merely cutting down on this without awareness of why we're doing it doesn't work. None of this is an end in itself. So having a simpler, sustainable lifestyle of using sustainable products, etc., that cannot become a mania in itself. The idea is simply to don't exhaust your energy, don't make a culture of demanding peak performance in any area of survivability, as it were. You know, in other words, don't overdo it, any of that. Just a moderate type of life and culture, moderate, and use all your energy and time for the spiritual path. That is the right setup. That's the setup that leads to deliverance. The other one does not lead to deliverance. It leads to disaster. The world's really headed into some very, very strange. The future is so strange, you know, we cannot even comprehend it, really. What's going to happen in the future of this planet? If you saw it, you'd think it's science fiction. But we don't realize the kind of strain we've placed on the planet. This notion, we all want to be peak performers. We all want to have the trophies of peak performance all around us. And again, don't judge oneself over this, because when in Rome, do as Romans do. To a limited extent, to a moderate extent, everybody does have some of those trophies around them. But one should be moderate in this, and then use all energy towards the spiritual path. That is the only sane way to go. Like, if someone asks me, can you do this? I say, no, I can't. I'm too tired. That's true. I'm too tired. I can't do that stuff, all this stuff. Cannot do it. If someone says, do you want to go to Hawaii? I'd say, no, I'm too tired. I can't do it. It's true. I can't travel. I'm too tired. Even if I could, if I had a free vacation to Hawaii, could I do it right now? Doubtful, the way I feel right now. And besides, what would you do in Hawaii? I guess you could lie on the beach, which would probably be nice. You could probably lie on the beach, and then, but still, it might even be too tired to even do that. Too much stress, too much strain. The travel and stuff, I'd just be exhausted. Do you want to go do this? No, I'm too tired. Do you want to do this? You want to do that? You want to build a resume of a peak performer. Say, yeah, I did this and 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 this. And then you check all the stuff off. You have a schedule. I don't even have a calendar or schedule of what I'm going to do, because I know I can't do much. But that's okay. Just do just the bare minimum necessary, and maybe a little bit more just for a flourish. But the majority of energy and time and focus is on clerical passion, pushing past these taboos of time, and then suffering the backlash of that, and then pushing for a little more. It's like shoveling snow off your walkway, one shovel full at a time. You know, you've got no one's going to do it for you. You got to keep shoveling that snow so you can walk along the pathway. It's tiring. So work is tiring. Work can be tiring. This is tiring work. Very tiring. It's a career. So you cannot put all your time and effort into some other career and think that you can put all your time and effort into this career. That's, you know, ludicrous to even suggest such a thing. Which is why traditionally in cultures, those who decide to take the spiritual path of inquiry, satsang, consideration, clarification, moving past the barriers of time, the taboos of time, they basically take a vow that this is what their life's going to be about, and then they're put into religious orders where it's not expected they be peak performers. That's, you know, nobody expects them to be peak performers in a household or life at all. They're not expected to keep up with fashion, any kinds of fashion. Not expected to with finery. They're not expected to accumulate any of the trophies of being a peak performer. All of that is not expected of them anymore. That's a sane society. So it's been seen that it's important to delineate between those who are more into peak performance and those who are not. But we don't do it anymore in this society. Last person you saw wearing a monastic robe or dress in out in public, it was when? Probably 15 years ago, or I can't even remember the last time I saw one. You have to go to India to see that. Which is why a lot of people did go to India. They said, hey, you know, how can I really drop out of this horrible, you know, demand to be a peak performer? And what's it like to be a guy who doesn't not expect to be a peak performer? So a lot of people went to India and checked it all out, checked out the scene. But they didn't, you know, wasn't quite, it doesn't translate well into this culture, really. A lot of people went in sustainable, more sustainable careers of agricultural careers, or some people organic, producing organic stuff, but even there, that they ended up being pushed into being peak performers in that, or else they'll go out of business. So the whole structure of that we live in is a peak performance structure, free market enterprise, capitalism, all that kind of stuff rewards peak performance. And the problem in the past of different systems like socialism is it's seen as the end in itself, as if that in itself is going to bring happiness. They say, let's just have no spiritual path at all, and everybody don't worry about any peak performance, and we'll all be happy, which is, of course, nonsense. You still have to be a peak performer on the spiritual path. So that hasn't worked either. So what you really need is a sane society. It's like India has had more of a sane social structure than other places in the world. And that's changing radically too these days, where the modern ideal of peak performance is now catching root among younger people. So, of course, for instance, in India, it used to be that if you were a renunciate, member of an order, religious order, then you were allowed to ride transportation without cost, of course, because you're not engaging in the world of commerce and profit. And so, you needed to go somewhere, you could ride for free. Now they've changed those laws now, so. Sort of pushing everybody into a profit-oriented lifestyle. But as we have seen, that becomes extraordinarily stressful. I think one thing we're finding out right now is the toll that it takes on everyone. Because there's this frantic competition for everybody to have more, to be a peak performer, which means they have to do better than you, or you have to do better than them. And the competition is just unbelievably severe. And sure, it knocks down prices for consumer goods, etc., stuff that we don't really need. But there's always constantly new products being introduced that say, hey, I can make profit on this, and then pushing advertising on people to make them think that they have this need, what they don't really have, creating all sorts of artificial needs, wants, and desires. And so we've got ourselves into a horrible mess, and it was completely foreseen and foreseeable, and it was transparent the entire time, and many people spoke out against it and saying this is all wrong. Many people, they turned out to be right. And yet there's something, those who are addicted to time worshippers are heedless, and they don't pay attention. So they've brought this catastrophe down on themselves. But those who are not time worshippers, in no way should they have to face the consequences that the time worshippers, that the peak performance idealists have brought upon themselves. In no way should they have to suffer the same fate. I think that those who warned the world said, we've warned you, and we've led you to water. We can't force you to drink. We can't force you to change your ways. But if you don't change your ways, you will certainly suffer the consequences of it. But then there's nothing that says those who spread all the warnings have to remain here and suffer the consequences. There's nothing that says that. If you go into some place and tell people to stop human sacrifice and you explain to them that's not the right thing, and they decide they're going to continue on with it, well, you don't have to stay there and end up being a sacrifice. You've done your job. You can't force people to change. Especially when it comes to pushing past the taboos of time. So, you do your utmost, you warn people their utmost, they don't listen. Lesson learned. The warning doesn't seem to work. And at some point, we're justified in recognizing that, wow, the world really hasn't listened. And this is a struggle, because we feel anytime you put in a great effort, you want to see results. And so we think that there must be results. I just have to hang in here to see the results. Well, maybe there's not results. The severity of fear within the time worshippers is so much that they can really turn a deaf ear to it all, and they have what's going on? They sort of stop recording here. They have a feeling like they know better, and that somehow they're going to succeed no matter, and that you're somehow trying to hold them back from success. But it really means they're defending against the fear of annihilation. And so they feel that how they're defending against it is the best defense there is. Now, that may be so, but the fact is that we don't need to choose an idea that gives rise to mental chaos. We can exchange that idea for another, and then we won't need the defense against it. So that's the fact that they're missing. So the warnings are not sufficient. The world has not turned in the right direction. It's too late. It's way too late. The damage, the stress on the world has been done. And what I've always been shown is that problems will come. The problems are going to come in this world. It simply is time worshippers always bring these problems down on their heads. So the effort is to at least reach those who want to be reached in this world. But you can't reach everybody here. You know, there's some really, the world is full of hardcore time worshippers now. Really hardcore. Who are incredibly wired for peak performance. And they're gobbling up all the power on this planet in setting up a control system for the planet. Micromanaging control system, a nanny state, a big mother state, as it were, watching everyone. George Orwell foresaw this, 1984, foresaw it very much. Brave New World, Aldous Huxley. Some of the really keen minds foresaw this, and spiritually it's been foreseen, of course. So what do those who are not time worshippers do? Well, we are trying to come up with this answer. I'm working on this answer. That is not yet, I cannot find that it's been revealed yet to the world. It is not. For some reason, it has not. Probably giving us time to mature in our understanding of the world is probably necessary. it's necessary for us to look at the world and say, wow, and really let it sink in what's going on. Because people are really astonished by what's happening. They truly are. They truly are. I remember listening to some person comment on that, famous person comment, saying they're truly dumbstruck by what's going on, and they weren't joking. Even people who you think would be able to handle it, they say, wow, no, I'm shocked by what's happening. And it if you aren't aware of any options, then what do? You just continue to be dragged down by it and shocked by it. So, from the get-go, all my videos have said, look, the spiritual path is absolutely essential. You have to start clarifying your options. Spiritual path is clarifying your options. Time doesn't believe you have an option. Time believes that time is it. This is it. Impermanence, this gradual loss is it. There's nothing else. So spiritual path is really becoming aware of what your options really are. And time tries to block that in every way possible. Because for time thinks it's only its option is either time or annihilation or total mental chaos. Well, that's the only option for time, but time is not our only option. You see, timelessness can be an option too for us. Completeness right now is an option for us. So we need to mature in that. I said, take the spiritual path, take the path of clarification, spend your time that way as much as possible. So at some point it'll dawn upon you, like, wow, the time worshippers really have messed everything up. They really are going to bring trouble down on our heads. They're really going to breed all sorts of resistant bugs and bacteria and plagues, etc., on the planet that we just can't even deal with. They're going to decimate the bee population of the planet. They're going to, bring severe droughts from weather problems and stress on the planet, severe droughts, problems with food, plagues. All this kind of stress and strain on the planet is coming home to roost now. And the time worshippers, what do? Push peak performance more than ever. More than ever. We need even greater peak performance. Just, they're addicts. Not knowing any other option. Being driven by fear, by panic, inner terror of mental chaos. So, unfortunately, we happen to be dwelling on the same planet at this time. Now, is that something that is necessary going forward? Do we really have to dwell on the same planet as these time worshippers is the question. Why should we? If we're like missionaries here, why should we always be forced to stay? Missionaries should be rotated. They shouldn't always have to stay in one place forever. Even the military understands that they rotate people off of the front lines. They don't leave people on the front lines forever. It's the same thing with tour duties. They don't leave people on the combat zone forever. They rotate them back home for some time back home before they deploy them again. So why should it be any different with people who are missionaries to this world of time, this place of time worshiping? It's exhausting here and difficult. Why should we always have to remain here, keep dwelling here in the same place? Shouldn't have to. Yeah, maybe just another taboo of time saying, oh no, you're stuck here, you can't leave. You have to stay with the time worshippers so they have a chance to indoctrinate you. No, we don't. Time wants to control and indoctrinate everyone, as a defense against mental chaos, of course. So understanding that, you got to get out of harm's way at some point. These people will not relent. Time worshippers don't relent. They don't have mercy. They are driven by the marching orders of time, which is to organize, control everything. You just have to have evidences of control everywhere. Everything's a gadget. Everything's a machine. Everything's a process. Everything's a bureaucracy. Have a million laws everywhere. Whatever you do, you're like a robot. And just everything is robotic and controlled and all this way. Just a horrible, horrible scenario. And even that, it's not enough. Never enough. then they'll start the controlled deaths, you know. That comes into play too. When the mania grips you of control, you eventually say, okay, this group here, it's their time to die. And then this group's next, and this group's next. They have a whole list of everyone who's to die, what groups are to die, when, you know. Very orderly, very systematic, very controlled. Of course, we went through such a situation in Nazi Germany, of course, which is just a precursor, seeing what happens when time worshippers gain control. What happens? We know exactly what happens. That wasn't some anomaly at all. That was what you expect from time worshippers. Now the whole planet is in the grip of that ideology. The whole planet's been educated that way. Severe control, micromanagement, ordering everything, more and more and more and more control over everybody's lives, over the entire situation here. The whole planet's that way. So from a missionary standpoint, you have to say, hey, you know, at some point maybe my mission is over here. You know, it's did the best you could for as long as you could, and you know, you need a break for a while, things cool down here, and then at some point maybe you'll get back to it. But we should not be forced into remaining in the same place as these time worshippers who are bringing down destruction upon their heads. People say, well, you were never a missionary, didn't help at all. Well, if we didn't help at all, that's only because of the severity of the time worshippers' attitudes and addictions. We weren't able to get through to them. Not from a lack of effort. Not from a lack of peak performance in that area. Or perhaps we couldn't give peak performance because society was structured in such a terrible way that we weren't really able to do well like that. So, There are several questions coming up in the world that need to be answered. Do we have an option as far as dwelling place? Do we have an option? Do we have to stay here where the place where time worshippers are bringing disaster upon themselves? Do we really have to remain in that? And that's a major question. Will we get some help here as far as bliss goes, as far as dwelling in bliss? Will we get some examples of that? That's another question. We have various questions that we're trying to get answered here, and we need the maturity to understand the answer. We are told in prophecy that the world cycles will eventually, the time worshippers will gain complete control of this planet, and they will bring disaster down on their heads. And at that point, there is going to be an exodus from this planet. That is what we've been told. That's what the Bible tells us. And I think other prophecies also are along that lines too, that there will be some sort of exodus from this planet to another dwelling place. Now, I just heard a pastor's interpretation of this, saying that hopefully this is okay, that it was interesting hearing this, that the idea of Jesus saying, don't be troubled, I will return and take you to the dwelling place I have prepared for you. That way, he has a dwelling place for you. That's their interpretation. Now, I don't see it that way, because Jesus was time specific about it. He said that he would return at the end of the age. He wasn't just talking about someone dying and going into heaven a certain time. He was talking about this end age where the great tribulation period will occur, when time worshippers have gained control of the planet and are bringing destruction down on their heads. That is when he would return and take all those who wanted to go to a dwelling place he has prepared. So, you know, that's how I see it. That seems that that's what's being said there. And if you see yourself as a missionary here on this planet, then certainly you have every right to take a vacation. Every right to take a vacation. You've done your best, and if it wasn't good enough, that's only because the resistance was so severe. So if you've done the best you can, or close to it, that's good enough. You deserve a vacation, absolutely. And if you know the whole scope of the situation, you're not defeated. You're not despondent. You just say, well, the time worshippers are tough nuts to crack, that is for sure. And we understand why, because they're driven by this panicked fear of mental chaos. And we need a society to be structured in such a way so as we do not emphasize peak performance and can withstand the fatigue of the spiritual path. So there's lots of things I've learned here as a missionary in this planet. Lots of situations that will stand me in very good stead in the future, as a matter of fact. It's been quite a learning situation. And one of them is you don't expect success in a society that is structured around peak performance. You're not going to get it. You're not going to get it. So you have to pick and choose your times and places and situations to help out. And you, when the barriers fall that prevent an ideology of peak performance from gaining traction, then your success rates are going to go way down, and the situation will eventually grind to a halt, and you'll go through some problem period. And that's the time then to take a vacation. So, you know, who has the wisdom to set aside all these toys and say they're not important? You might go to another dwelling place where people are seeing a very simple lifestyle. You think they're primitive, but it may be comprised of people who have set down their toys, all these sophisticated toys, says that we don't need this stuff. It's like somebody has a garage full of exotic race cars, and I know people that actually have those. Quite a few, actually. Some of them, like 20 different, you know, super exotic, expensive vehicles. And then one day you see them and they're riding a bicycle and they say, where's your car? He says, oh, I got rid of the cars. That was just, you know, just a little obsession I had. It was just wasting my time and money and effort and everything like that. And then I'm no longer interested in all those cars. And so they just got a bicycle. You see, they let go of all their toys, their silly toys. It's just a phase. So, simplicity does not mean that someone is naive, not necessarily. Sometimes the people who have the simplest lifestyle might have led a very sophisticated peak performance lifestyle previously, and they learned a lesson and said, that's not it. That's a waste of my time. It didn't get me what I wanted. So now they're using their time wisely and choosing to be simple. In India, you know, they're not naive. The real heavyweights, no, they know human nature and the situation here. They have extremely wide perspective. Very impressive of them. These days, not so much. Not so much. I've not come across the heavyweights in India. Can't find them anymore. I'm just not impressed. The impressive ones are old at this time. I do have come across some that are like 85, you know, they're late 80s kind of thing. They're old. You don't come across, but other than that, I really can't find it anymore. The bar's been lowered. But they can live very simple lifestyles. Renunciate, detached. Simple. And not because they're dumb. It's because they're wise. And they say, no, I'm not going to get engaged in all that foolishness. Probably some previous life they were highly engaged. It might have been some mogul, some great Khan, you know, great ruler, very super sophisticated business people and all this kind of stuff. And they said, nah, that okay, lesson learned. That's not it. So the religious renunciates are not necessarily naive, stupid people who are incapable of peak performance. Most of them have realized peak performance in the world is not where it's at. It's peak performance on the spiritual path that's where it's at. And they've realized that. And now that's what they're doing. And society in general recognizes us and say, no, these people are superior to us. Way superior. And they're wiser, way wiser. So we respect them and we give them we help them. If they need food, we give them food. If we have a little extra, we'll give it to them. If they need shelter, we'll give them shelter. If we need transportation, we'll give them transportation, because they help all the rest of us avoid the snares and pitfalls of existence, of time worshiping. They help us out with that. So, of course, it's a win-win situation for such a society. Society recognizes the wisdom of those who have the simplicity and detachment from external peak performance. They recognize that. Then that comes back to them and help to avoid the snares of time worshiping. So everybody wins. Everybody wins. Right now we have a lose-lose situation in the world. It's a lose-lose. And what happens is that spirals down the drain. It's pretty much the toilet's already been flushed. And we're just, you know, watching the circling as it goes down. At some point, whew, it's gone. You know, we're gone. We're goners here. But everybody's still, you know, trying to squeeze out more peak performance. We're trying to identify the ones who can solve the problem. So everybody needs to just work like crazy on this thing. And then we'll squeeze the peak performers to the top, and then they'll tell everybody else what to do. And we think that's the answer. But the stress is already there. The problem with fresh water in the world is going to be a, you know, huge problem. Everything is going to become just an enormous burden, requiring enormous control of everyone's lifestyle. People will be born, they will belong to the state, the control apparatus. They won't belong to parents at all, or grandparents, uncles, aunts, siblings, grandparents, relatives, culture. No, won't belong to them at all, will belong to the state, the control apparatus. Because they say this person is a potential disruptor of control, and is a user of scarce resources. They have to be indoctrinated and controlled from early age into exactly how to function under a control situation. So we're so far along in all of this that we should be looking for answers, should be expecting answers, mature in wisdom, which we are doing, which is putting the whole thing in the right context, getting the lessons learned that are here. If we realize we've learned our lessons here, then we're not attached to the situation. Whereas if we're still totally confused and why what's going on, then we may feel attachment to the situation. But if we say, yeah, I get it. I understand why I've had problems here, the difficulty of all this, what's going on in the world, et cetera, et cetera. Then you can say, okay, it's not overwhelmed. I'm not overwhelmed by the lessons. I've learned them. I can go somewhere else. I can take a vacation. I can take a vacation. That's okay. When I come back to it, I'll understand the challenges. I'll be able to look at the big picture. I won't be overwhelmed by it anymore. And I understand the difficulty of it. All of that. So it's okay to take a vacation. I tend to be very harsh on myself, saying no vacations ever, because I still don't get it. But now I'm more and more I'm getting it and saying, ah, okay, it's a systemic thing. It's the strength of time worshiping comes from defending against this mental chaos, and it's such a severe fear that the time worshippers don't even give a second of their lives to consider any other option. And so in such a situation, you cannot succeed. There has to be certain circumstances where people are not into peak performance for whatever reason. Any help has to be carefully thought out in advance of how we're going to be helped. You cannot just go into any situation and expect to have success. This is not possible. I think we have this ideal of somehow we should be able to turn anything around. We say in Christ all things are possible. We should be able to miracles and just turn everything around. So it's not true. It is not true. I haven't seen that at all. That's an ideal. That's spiritual idealism. I've not seen it being turned around at all. Just the opposite. Really, the more you push time worshipers, the worse things get. The more pressure they feel to take a spiritual path, the more bound to time they become. It's counterproductive. It can be counterproductive. So, I've been raised on this ideal of that you should be able to help others, and if you can, it's because there's something wrong with you. And I'm saying that's not true. It is absolutely not true. I reject that whole constellation of belief, really. It's my experience is simply not true at all. Make things worse if you push when the situation is not ripe, you try to ripen it prematurely, it makes it worse. People retreat back into fear, into time worshiping, into peak performance ideologies. You have to tread very lightly, and you have to pick and choose your times and places of helping others, because a lot of times they don't welcome the help, and they don't want it. So that's something that I would, really suggest people look at. And maybe we should stop blaming ourselves for ineffectiveness. And you just wonder, who is it that's pushing this whole agenda of somehow we have to be effective? Maybe it's not possible. Maybe it's time itself that's pushing this agenda. It's the one that wants to be effective, that's maniacally insistent on effectiveness. Those who have just exchanged hypotheticals are in bliss. They're not feeling any need to be effective. They don't feel that at all. They're not defending against annihilation. So they wait. They don't feel any problem with waiting for the right time, right place. They're not driven by a need to be peak performers or anything. They're just wise. They say, well, we'll wait until they're receptive and then we'll help out. But that doesn't cause them any feeling of panic or fear to be that way. They're not under pressure to be a peak performer. So the spiritual missionaries should not be under pressure to be peak performers in that way. I never got the sense from the great gurus that they were under some strain or pressure to be peak performers here and save everybody. They were perfectly willing for things to drag on, if necessary. For them to be ineffective, even. If that happens to be, if they're ineffective in some ways, that's fine with them. It doesn't cause them any worry or concern. So, again, the issue of taking a vacation from this very arduous, difficult missionary work that may have run its course at this point. There's that. And then there's the issue of where vacation could possibly be. There's the issue of choosing bliss instead of incompleteness. The affirmations. And then hopefully some in the world will showcase that for us. These are the kind of the basic issues that we have right now. And trying to mature ourselves so that we can accept the answers to these questions, which is what we've been doing. So I wouldn't be surprised at all if the answers didn't come soon, during the month of May. I wouldn't be surprised. Would not be a surprise at all. I'm just checking with myself now. If that happened, would it be a surprise? No. Is there any anxiety? No. There's no kind of change in breathing or anything like that. No gripping of the breathing or anything like that. No, it's just still smooth. Everything's still smooth. So in other words, would it be smooth if that happened? Yes, it would be smooth. It would be something smooth. So That's very great. We will continue on in this arduous effort to provide to showcase the options that we really have here. That could be quite substantial options going forward. So stay tuned for that, and we will keep pressing this issue as much as we can, keeping in mind that the effort is very fatiguing here. All right, very fatiguing, but I'm able to, so far, I'm able to keep doing it. All right, very great, that's it.